I finally upgraded to the M4 Max Mac Studio, and I put it head-to-head with my 3-year-old M1 Max Mac Studio, transcribing hours of audio with AI, while encoding hours of 4K footage in compressor, and even throwing machine learning super resolution from Pixelmator Pro. And after all that testing, I know how much faster it is in real-world use compared to my old one. By the way, this is actually my old one, my M1 Max, because I already set up and replaced it with my M4. So there's the M1 and the M4. I'm also going to share the specs that I chose to upgrade to, why I chose a clean install rather than Migration Assistant. And in the end, I'll answer the question, is it worth it upgrading from an M1 or M2 to the M4? So I got the first Mac Studio when it launched. That was in 2022, and I got the M1 Max version with 64 gigs of unified memory. And my old one had a 10-core CPU, 8 performance, 2 efficiency, and 32-core GPU. Now I upgraded that processor and the storage on this M1 Max. I went up to the 2 TB SSD, but I could never keep my iCloud photo library downloaded locally because of its size, which is one of the reasons I upgrade, which this 2025 M4 Max Studio has 128 gigabytes of unified memory. Got the 16-core CPU, 12 performance, 4 efficiency. Graphics-wise, it's got the 40-core GPU. And yes, it was not inexpensive, but I went all the way to the 8 TB SSD and downloaded my entire iCloud photo library. With even after doing that, I've only taken up 1.4 terabytes of the 8 total. I know technically you can put your iCloud photo library on an external drive, yada yada. I wanted it on my local machine, and maybe a 4 TB would have worked, but at that point, I just kind of wanted to go all the way. And so I did have the satisfying moment of clicking download originals to this Mac, and in one night, my entire iCloud photo library is now on this machine. Now on setup, I chose not to do Migration Assistant. And while I probably could have cleaned up my old machine and just moved over the apps that I needed, I had the Adobe Creative Suite on there, I had Zoom, Chrome, and I didn't want any of those on my new machine. So I started from scratch, downloaded all the apps I needed from the App Store, downloaded a few which are outside the App Store, things like the companion app for my Blackmagic 810 Mini Pro, Audio Hijack. I do use the Brave web browser when I'm recording with Riverside, and CleanShot X where I do all my local screen recording. If you want to see every app that I install on a new Mac, I just did this with my M4 MacBook Air. I'll link that video above and down in the description. And honestly, because I keep all my files in iCloud Drive and many of the apps that I've bought are through the Mac App Store, setting up is pretty easy. It took me about 2 hours starting from a complete blank slate all the way to getting it set up exactly how I want. And one of the things that helps me expedite that process is in my iCloud Drive, in Documents, I have a folder that I call Backup, and this is where I save things like Audio Hijack sessions. And here I can just import the sessions that I use, and they're ready to go. It remembers all the folders that I'm saving files to, the inputs, all of that. Also for the companion app, which I use with my Stream Deck and Blackmagic 810 Mini, I have all of that. Compressor presets, I can import quickly. So just having this backup folder in iCloud Drive with all the things that don't sync over when you re-download an app from the Mac App Store, it lets me get up and running very fast. Oh, Hazel is another one I install outside the App Store. Again, check out that other video where I talk about all this. And before we get to the speed test, let me answer the Mac Studio versus Mac Mini question. For a lot of people, especially if you're doing video editing, the M4 Pro Mac Mini is probably enough computer for most people. It's plenty fast. But one of the reasons, well, 9 of the reasons I love the Mac Studio are the ports, and I use every single one. Now, while the port configuration is basically the same, you do get Thunderbolt 5 on the new M4 Max or M3 Ultra versions, where it was Thunderbolt 4 on my older M1 Mac. The M4 Max also has Wi-Fi 6E, still not 7 for whatever reason, and Bluetooth 5.3 compared to the M1 Max version. And I went M4 Max because I knew in my heart of hearts the M3 Ultra was even more overkill for what I need. But if you did go M3 Ultra, technically you can go up to a 16 terabyte SSD. So I didn't go too crazy. So on the back of the Mac Studio, you get those 4 Thunderbolt ports plus 10 gigabit Ethernet, 2 USB-A ports, which I still use, HDMI and headphone jack out. So on my Mac Studio, I have my studio display connected to 1 Thunderbolt port, my 810 Mini Pro in another, a CalDigit Elements Thunderbolt dock, which I have multiple SSDs and things like my Stream Deck pedal connected. And then the last Thunderbolt port, I actually connect my Rodecaster Pro because I want it directly connected, not through a hub. Of course, I plug in Ethernet because I'm all about the speed. 2 USB-A ports, one I use for my mechanical keyboard, another for the Stream Deck that's on top of my desk. I have the HDMI going out to my 810 Mini Pro, which there's the 810 Mini Pro. Here's the M1 Max. There's the M4 Max. There's my Stream Deck. And then you'll see the Mac Studio secondary display is actually an input on the ATEM. So using the companion app and the Stream Deck here to switch, I could technically put the Mac screen there as my program output, as well as my camera 1 and camera 2. Technically, I don't really use the headphone jack all the time, but when I do plug in a pair of headphones, if it's not into the Rodecaster Pro 2, it's directly here to the Mac Studio. And that is every single port being used. And I do often use the front ports to import footage on my Osmo Pocket 3, maybe a USB drive, and the SD card slot I use all the time. So yeah, I want the ports. Oh, and also, this thing was super dusty when I picked it up, so if you do get a Mac Studio, you might want to check every once in a while the grate underneath, because it's sucking in air all the time. But to clean it, before I send it back trade-in to Apple, which they did give me about $750 trade-in value for the old Mac Studio, I know I could have gotten more in a private sale, and I did offer it to somebody, but they didn't want it. To clean it up, I used one of my Hoto accessories. I have screwdrivers and this, which I just love. It has a vacuum attachment. Turn this on, and now you can vacuum. And you can also put another attachment on this side to use it as an air blower to get stuff out of your keyboard and stuff like that. I'll link this down in the video description, as well as an Amazon link to the M4 Mac Studio, you know, if you want to get one. And yes, those are affiliates. But now let's get to the speed tests. So I first put the M1 Max and M4 Max side by side, exporting videos that I would typically compress. I do use compressor because I like batching things, doing an MP3 file before the video. This way I can start transcribing it right away. And so I sent a batch of two 4K videos, compressing it to an MP3 and a 4K MP4 at the same time. The M1 Max, my old Mac Studio, did it in 18 minutes, 17 seconds, while the new M4 Max did it in 15 minutes, 11 seconds. Not a huge difference. It is 3 minutes faster on the new machine, and multiply that by all the videos I export. Nice to have a little speed bump there. But I knew that I was not using it to its full potential, so I did an even bigger test. I opened a Pixelmator Pro document and resized a thumbnail image to 50,000 pixels wide using its ML Super Resolution. I was going to run that as well as running Transcriptionist, my favorite app for transcribing on the Mac. It's made by the same developer who makes Ferrite, the app that I use to edit all my podcasts. And I confirmed with the Transcriptionist developer that it's going to be pinging those GPU cores while it's transcribing. To be clear, I use the medium English-only brain here in Transcriptionist. There's lots of models you can choose from, but I use the same one on both. That was going to be transcribing a 6.5-hour audio file. It's actually the Berkshire Hathaway 6.5-hour video that's on YouTube, but I compressed it to MP3 first before putting it in Transcriptionist. And then I also gave it a 3.5-hour Final Cut project, compressing that into ProRes 4K video, and then I ran all of it at the same time. Now the first task to finish was the Pixelmator Pro document, increasing it with machine learning. The M1 Max did it in 6 minutes, 39 seconds, while the M4 Max did it in 4 minutes and 9 seconds. So 2-minute increase in speed for that Pixelmator Pro resolution increase. Now once that was finished, the next task was transcribing it. And this was a significant difference. On the M1 Max, my older Mac Studio, it took it 35 minutes and 47 seconds to transcribe that 6.5-hour audio file, whereas the M4 Max did it in almost half the time, at 18 minutes, 29 seconds. Now, I transcribe a lot of audio, my own audio mostly, because I'll transcribe a video while I'm uploading it to YouTube, so then I can run through ChatGPT, get suggestions, tags, things like that. So knowing I'm going to be saving time transcribing, and maybe I'll choose a more advanced brain to get accurate transcriptions, I can do it with the M4 Max, and it's still going to happen pretty fast. Now, when it came to encoding that video, it was still running, and on the M1 Max, it actually failed around 30-something minutes, so the project never completed. On the M4 Max, it was still chugging along at 40 minutes. It was about half done, but I decided to stop it. So that was probably going to be about an hour, 15 minutes to finish compressing that video file, but the M1 Max didn't even handle it. It just quit. So as you would expect, the M4 Max is faster in all those things. Pixelmator Pro, graphic, and resolution increase. Compressing video files that I sent from Final Cut to Compressor, but most of all, that transcriptions, again, which I do a lot, actually had the best increase in performance. And I looked at the activity monitor while I was running those tests, and it was clear that Transcriptionist was making use of those GPU cores as it was transcribing. I also saw a ton of memory usage from Pixelmator Pro as it was doing that ML resolution, and it went all the way into swap memory, meaning it's starting to use the SSD for some memory, in addition to the built-in RAM, or unified memory in Apple's case. Didn't have to use as much swap on the M4 Max because I have the 128 gigabytes of memory. So yeah, turns out the M4 Max is faster than the M1 Max. Who would have thought? But is it worth upgrading from what you have right now? I'll be honest, I've been using the M1 Max for the last 3 years, doing live broadcasts, webinars, recording every single video you've seen on this YouTube channel. It was done using this M1 Max Mac Studio, literally. Well, some of them were edited on my M4 MacBook Air and my M1 Pro MacBook Pro, but anyway, this Mac Studio has been powering all of the content I make for 3 years, and it wasn't really choking on what I was doing now. It was plenty fast, It never missed a beat. I think if I was at the time able to upgrade the internal SSD to maybe 4 terabytes instead of 2, I would have been hard pressed on actually upgrading now, because that M1 Max was still doing a great job. Yes, you're gonna have some time savings, but we're talking minutes, not really hours, unless you're doing 12, 24 hours of transcriptions and 6, 8, 10 hour video compressions. So if you have an M1 or M2 Max or even Pro, I would only think about upgrading if there's other reasons like getting more unified memory or a bigger SSD that are a part of the equation. But if you're just looking for a speed improvement and you do stuff like I do, which is videos like this, and to be clear, my typical Final Cut projects look like this, 4K 30 timeline. I do have multicam clips, so I have my A-roll, my B-roll, a screen grab, and audio. So it's doing all that. But again, the M1 Max was handling all of this with no problem, and I was able to export my videos pretty fast. So I think the bottom line is, if you're happy with your storage and unified memory, and you have any M1 series or newer chip, you're probably good for a while. If you can't upgrade and you want to, I mean, go for it. That's basically what I did. But the M series chips are just that good that even my M1 Max here was still handling it just fine after 3 years and could have gone for many more. I'm also glad I went with the M4 Max rather than the M3 Ultra. To upgrade anything on the M3 Ultra gets really pricey, and you don't get all the memory options that you do on the M4 Max. Like, you can't get 128 gigs of unified memory, you have to jump up to 256, and now this is already more than what I spent on the M4 Max, and this only comes with 1 terabyte of SSD storage. So if you're looking to upgrade to the new Mac Studio, really know you're gonna use that M3 Ultra chip, and if you're not sure, get the M4 Max. It's going to be way plenty for what you need, and it should last me for years, unless I want to upgrade sooner than that, but we'll see. Let me know if you have any stress tests you want me to put the M4 Max through down in the comments. Don't forget to subscribe and hit that like button. WWDC is coming up, and I'm gonna be covering it all right here on the channel from iOS 19, whatever new comes for iPad, any new hardware. It's all going to be right here. And if you want to see that video about all the apps that I install on every new Mac, I'll link that right up here. Or if you're into shortcuts, I have another shortcut video coming very soon, so stay tuned for that. But I'll put my latest one here, and I would love if you join my shortcuts community. You can do that at create.beard.fm. We have almost 1,500 people as part of the community, so thank you for that. And over 300 of you support with $5 a month or $50 a year. And if you do that, you get access to my shortcut of the week, where I post a new shortcut that you won't see in any of my videos, only for paying members. Plus, you can access my Shortcuts GPT, which I've trained to help you use APIs from things like the National Weather Service, Movie Database, and more. And I use it to match text, which is really helpful. Plus, if you have a shortcuts request, I have an entire place where I prioritize those who pay to be in the community, and I make sure to reply and try to build every single one. So again, you can join the community at create.beard.fm. You can check out the videos I talked about right up here. And thank you for watching. I'll catch you next time.